and I'm so happy to see all of you here. This is the best way to end a winter rhythm. Great cast of people, songs about hope. What more can we ask for? Thank you. And if anybody wants to take home those poinsettias out there, be my guest. Otherwise, they're going to be thrown out. So grab them. And now, thank you, you're here. And if you want to know more what Urban Stages is doing throughout the year, please sign up on our patrons mail list. We won't give you mail every day, just maybe once a month. We'd love to have you come back. Now, the man of the hour, Tom Toce.
Thank you, Francis. So this is the 20th of 20 shows in the Winter Rhythms Festival. My spiel is about the festival is gone. I don't have any, I don't have to put in any more plugs about other shows that you can come to. This is it. So I'll be mercifully short on that, except to express my appreciation to Francis Hill, the founding artistic director of Urban Stages, for inviting me to produce this festival. To my predecessor, Peter Napolitano, who, you know, something about standing on the shoulders of giants, that really made Winter Rhythms very easy for this, my first year. On sound is, I got Doug Mills on sound and Kim Sharp on lights have been a producer's dream come true as far as helping the shows run very smoothly. Everybody really at Urban Stages, Antoinette and Ilana and, help me out.
Olga.
Big help, great support for this. The production manager, Victoria Orton, I couldn't have done it without her. So please join me in thanking all of you. I'm sure I'm bound to forget something, but now I have to move into the other hat that I'm wearing. So in producing a festival, most of the shows had other producers, but I actually produced three of them, including this one. So now I have to seamlessly move from producing the festival to producing the show. Welcome to Songs of Hope. I don't think that I really have to explain to anybody why Songs of Hope are important. The one thing that I'll say to kick off this show is that what hope means to me is Greek mythology, something about Prometheus stealing fire, something about Epimetheus, his brother, being married to Pandora. Something about the gods putting all the evils of the world into a jar. Not a box, a jar. Something about Pandora opening the jar and unleashing all of the evils of the world. And there was just one thing left in the jar. What was that?
Hope.
So that's the idea of the evening, Songs of Hope. So I'd like to welcome to the stage our music director for the evening, Jon Delfin. And the first song of Hope is one of mine. A sometime collaborator of mine, a wonderful composer named Kim Older, sent me a tune a few months ago. And being a songwriter is an act of hope a lot. You're hoping that you don't screw it up. I was hoping that I didn't screw up this melody. It was really lovely, lullaby kind of melody. And so I wrote it after a sleepover that my grandson had one night. And so this is the song that emerged from that sleepover. Lavin can wait. How old are you? You'll say six. I'm familiar with your tricks. What's your hurry, little guy? Seasons change and days fly by. Nothing wrong with being just five. Someday time will eat you alive. Years from now you'll think of this night, and my love, which shines like a light. Day has ended, time for bed. All tomorrow lies ahead. Sing our bedtime song again. Music makes us better men. Sing our bedtime song again. Music makes us better men. I was confusing like Hamantaschen with the Mennonites or something, and it came out wrong. But a man who is going, I'm going to welcome out to the piano next, is going to tell us all about what it means to be Hamisha, Mr. Douglas J. Cohen. A few things to tell you about Doug. Doug is a longtime friend of mine. In fact, in September, Doug sang a song at my daughter Julia's wedding. I believe Julia is here tonight. She was supposed to be.
We could reprise it.
Right. So Doug sang at Julia's wedding. I was best man at Doug's wedding long ago. So Doug is part of the family and one of the greatest guys that I know. His musical, The Evolution of Man, just closed at the Cell Theater. It was wonderful. And I'm told there is an original cast album of it coming out in February. Doug.
Thank you, Tom. And thank you for putting it together, this whole event and this whole series. Tom always says, when you want something done, ask a busy person. And no one is busier or more successful at doing this than you are, Tom. So my hat's off to you, if I was wearing one. So this song that I'm going to be performing for you, I wrote a number of years ago, and but given the exceptionally volatile times that we inhabit, I think it seems rather timely. Don't know if there's a God. These days he likes to keep one guessing, but still I'll give a nod, saying thanks for every blessing. The rhapsody in blue, the scent of evergreens, the golden age of Burns and Allen's old routines. Thanks for ruby shoes and yellow submarines, and thank you for today. Thank you for the kicks from towering rockets. Thank you for the Met, and even for the Mets. Every bouncy note in Great Berlin duets, and thank you. Every time I fall, thank you for while love is here to stay. Every passing moment is a precious gift. I lift my voice and say,
someone happy, and I wish it so. Mardie is fronting with her band, the Habibi Kings. That's her Middle Eastern band at Swing 46 on January 31st, and they will be joined by members of the Broadway show, the band, the band's visit. So please welcome Mardie Millit.
Songs and my relationship to them, but the people who wrote these lyrics are much better writers than I am, so I'm just gonna do the songs and I hope you enjoy them.
For I wish it so. What a
bouncing back and forth between people I've known forever and people I've known a short period of time, we come next to Renee Katz, who's going to sing a song by Maury Yeston. Now, Maury, who wrote on Broadway 9 and Titanic and The Grand Hotel, Maury is responsible as much as anyone for my being here tonight and my being a songwriter. Maury was my music theory professor in college. And when Maury Yeston is your music theory professor, you know, you learn a lot about a lot of things. Maury would intersperse his counterpoint lessons with a little Bach and a little Jelly Roll Morton. So my favorite work of Maury's actually is not Titanic or Nine. My favorite work of Maury's is a song cycle that he wrote for Andrea Markovici called December Songs. And here to sing I Am Longing from December Songs is Renee Katz.
This song speaks of opening our heart for the possibility of finding love. I am longing to thank you.
now and then I'm going to forget things. So I should have said before she started that Reedy will be appearing on May 21st at what she referred to as a Jerome Kern thing at the Mabel Mercer Foundation. But it's the thing is at Carnegie Hall. And then in the winter, she'll be reprising her terrific show, Winter Awakenings, and I believe that's in January at Don't Tell Mama. So look for both those things from Renee Katz. Speaking of Don't Tell Mama, the booking agent at Don't Tell Mama is a man named Sidney Myer. Sidney is well known in the cabaret world, and he's especially well known for singing comedy songs, which causes me always to think of asking him to sing serious songs, because A, that's the way my mind works, and B, I think there's something great about a comic sensibility. If you can do comedy, you can do anything. So here to sing what I think is a non-comic song, Sidney Myer.
Yeah.
Thank you.
so one of the joys of putting this show together is learning new songs. I did not know that song, which is by Candor and Ebb, I believe.
No.
By David Yazbek.
Yeah, David
Yazbek. Oh, sorry. I didn't know that song by David Yazbek. But the song that Steve sang, called Yes, is by Candor and Ebb, but I didn't know that one either. Maybe I got confused by the songs that I didn't know. But I do know the next song. In fact, this was on my list of suggested songs to singers, and Natalie Douglas picked me up on it. So let me welcome to the stage Natalie Douglas, who will be singing two shows New Year's Eve at the Duplex.
True.
So hard to choose.
I know, decisions, decisions. Hi, kids, how are you? Thank you. Yes, he's correct. This will actually be our 20th New Year's celebration in the Village this year. And yeah, it's exciting. And as some of you who've been with me on New Year's Eve know that I do a year-end wrap-up, not just the personal year, but you know, the world. But this year there's a lot going on in the personal. I found my birth father this year.
Wow.
And yeah, it's cool. We just met and he's fabulous. And it added to the family. I was very lucky. My adoptive family was wonderful, and I adore them all. But now I have lots more family. And so when it came to singing this song, I thought, this is a good reminder that even when you don't know it, there's somebody around you who loves you.
I will let
vision of hope here at Winter Rhythms. But resilience is, that's one of the most important aspects, I think, of hope. So this next song was also on my list of suggested songs that I thought were appropriate for the evening. And I want to give a little bit of an introduction to this song, which is called Count Your Blessings Instead of Sheep. About 8 years ago, I was coming back from a funeral in Queens, and I stood by and watched my daughter, Julia, get hit by a truck. So, Julia, you'll be happy to know, is the same daughter that Doug sang at her wedding a couple of months ago. So what I said at the time is that when you start the sentence, "Today my daughter got hit by a truck," and you end it with, "and she broke her arm very badly," that's a very lucky day. And shortly after that, a week or so later, I was driving somewhere and had some CDs on, and Rosemary Clooney's version of Count Your Blessings came on. I don't know if you know it, but Rosemary Clooney is one of my favorite singers, and she kills me with that. So I had to pull off the side of the road when I started hearing Rosemary Clooney sing Count Your Blessings. So here to sing Count Your Blessings is an old friend of mine, Cynthia Crane. So let me welcome to the stage Cynthia Crane.
Thank you, my dear. What a lucky group we are to have Tom Toce with us.
Yes.
Tom once wrote a song for one of my CDs, and I'm so proud of that song. I sing it every chance I get. It's called Out of Fashion, and I dearly love it. He wrote it with Lou Spence. But not only does he write songs, he produces things that give us all the chance to perform for you, and that's, for me, a great gift. So thank you, darling.
Thank you.
When I'm worried, blessings instead of sheep, and I fall asleep counting my blessings. When my bankroll is getting small, I think of when I had none at all, and I fall asleep counting my blessings. I think about a nursery and I picture curly heads, and one by one I count them as they slumber in their beds. When my worries are getting small, then I think I have none at all, 'cause I fall asleep counting my blessings.
Amen. mention about Cynthia that her cabaret show, this is, oh boy, this is a crazy world, my dear, whether you like it or not. Is that what it's called? I hastily wrote this down. Anyway, Cynthia will be reprising that show in March at Don't Tell Mama. So coming up next is a relatively new friend of mine, Lauren Stanford, and she's going to sing a song by Ben Folds. Now, anybody who knows me knows that I'm a big Ben Folds fan, and John is going to play the piano instead of Ben Folds, because when Ben Folds plays the piano, he always breaks it. I've never been to a Ben Folds concert and not had him break the piano. So go on. This is a delicate, lovely song by Ben Folds. So here to sing it is Lauren Stanford. And let me tell you one or two things that Lauren asked me to tell you. Right. She won a Bistro Award last year for her Helen Morgan show, which was a wonderful show devoted to Helen Morgan. She is a Metro Star winner, and she is a wonderful singer, Lauren Stanford. Yes.
Sad news this week. One of my very close friends passed away, and I was so fortunate to have Tom ask me to do this concert and suggest this song because it, you know, working on it pulled me out of all of that for a moment and reminded me of gratefulness and hope. Grateful that he was in my life and hope that maybe we'll meet again and again. I don't get many things right the first time. In fact, I am told that a lot. Now I know all the wrong turns, the stumbles, the falls brought me here. And where was I before the day that I first saw your lovely face? Now I see it every day. Passed away. in his sleep. His wife, she stayed for a couple of days, then passed away. I'm sorry, I know that's a strange way to tell you that I know we belong, that I know that I am,
We went to the Metropolitan Museum of Art to see an exhibit by the architect Santiago Calatrava. Lou didn't go to college, and so all his life long, sort of like the scarecrow, he was one of the smartest guys I know, but he was always compensating for it because he felt he didn't have adequate schooling, and Lou was brilliant. Lou was a songwriter from the 40s and 50s who was just hitting his stride when the Beatles came, and he always felt as if the Beatles really kind of interfered with his career. He wasn't writing rock and roll. Lou wrote Nice and Easy for Frank Sinatra. And Cynthia mentioned Lou earlier. I did introduce Cynthia to Lou, and the first song that Lou and I ever wrote together was on her album. It was called Out of Fashion. The second song that we wrote together was, when I said goodbye to him at the Metropolitan Museum, he got into a cab, and he lived in Los Angeles, and he said, it's time to go back and write songs that nobody wants to sing. That was Lou. Then shortly after, a few months later, I learned that he had a stroke, a mild stroke, but a stroke, and I thought that what's the best way for a songwriter to recover from a stroke is to write a song. So I wrote a song called Because I Can, from Lou's point of view, about a songwriter. You know, why should I go back and write songs that nobody wants to sing? Because I can. And of course, that song then was of limited use because no one could sing it except for Lou, and Lou isn't with us anymore. However, I adapted the lyric to sing so that my friend Lynn Henderson could sing it, not about a songwriter now, but about a singer. So please welcome to the stage Lynn Henderson, accompanied by Doug Cohen on the piano, to sing Because I Can, the second song that Lou Spence and I wrote.
To me. 3 weeks ago, I could not walk. And I spent 3 weeks in rehab doing physical therapy, which was a huge help. But also, as I age, I'm realizing the body doesn't always do what you wanted it to do 20 years ago. And this song brings home that fact, the fact that we really have to be determined to carry on. On my good days, I'm old fashioned. On my bad, I'm out of date. You may wonder why I bother anymore. Why I spend my life performing songs that no one wants to hear. The reason's existential. Have you heard that song before? Because I can, because I must. because you want a classic song. Well, that's the plan. Because I must. Because I can. Because I must. Because I can. Because I tried and couldn't paint like Paul Gauguin. Because I've done this sort of thing my whole life long. And there you are, another song. On my good days, I'm old-fashioned. On my bad, I'm out of date. On my best days, though, my voice is true and clear. And I work to get things right so that my audience will know that something mattered, that I was here. And so to me, and here's the truth, there is a chord that is a pipeline to my youth.
Trazana Beverly is a Tony Award winner, and she is going to be accompanied by Toughest Zimbabwe, singing The Spirit Moves, which I believe is an original song by Trazana. So, The Spirit Moves, Trazana Beverly, please.
Good evening. I wrote the lyrics to this song some years ago for a one-woman show that I wrote entitled The Spirit Moves. And I got the title from something that my grandmother used to say all the time. The spirit moves, child. The spirit moves. God is a spirit. And I was thinking, no matter what religion or faith that you are a part of, being Muslim, Jewish, Christian, we usually have those grandmothers pray for us and tell us in their own special way. The spirit moves. Didn't know what she meant until I went through some things which inspired that one woman show called The Spirit Moves. I wrote the lyrics in collaboration with a composer named Mr. Ernest McCarthy.
Come
trust the spirit when it moves in your heart. His love is faithful. His love's forever. He'll never leave you. He won't deceive you.
Christine Lavin and Friends, and one of the great things about a Christine Lavin song or event is that you never know really what's going to happen. I looked up at one point and she was twirling a baton with lights on the end of it. So I don't know what Christine is going to do tonight. I'm not familiar with this song. I know she's not playing the guitar. So join me with your mouths wide open in awe of Christine Lavin.
Thank you, Tom. I don't make things up, I just make them rhyme. And this is a true story, a conversation I had with a bus driver in Minneapolis. It's called The Polka Dancing Bus Driver and the 40-Year-Old Mystery. He drives the Airport Express bus in Minneapolis. He plays polka music for the passengers he drives. He works Monday through Friday, the same shift every day. But it's on Saturdays and Sundays, he says, that he comes alive. My wife and I go polka dancing every single weekend. We've developed quite a style over 37 years. We met while roller skating, which soon led to dating and eventually to mating and settling right here. Now, I am not a braggart, but I can say with pride and joy that I've been graceful on my feet since I was a little boy. People stop and watch us dancing now. We know we must look smooth. My wife and I have memorized all of each other's moves. But one thing has always bothered me. When I was a kid, girls would never dance with me, no matter what I did. I know I wasn't handsome. The truth is, I was poor. I tried hard to be friendly. I don't think I was a bore. But all the girls that I approached simply shook their heads. So I'd retreat across the dance floor and hang out with my buddies there instead. And soon, I just stopped asking them. It was easier that way. Thank God my future wife walked into the roller rink that day. Last year, I went to the 40th reunion of my high school class. My wife and I danced all the dances, the slow ones and the fast, and I saw the girls, they're women now, would never dance with me. And all those awkward feelings came back the way it used to be. So I went right up to them, even though I was shaking all inside, and I said, "Something has always bothered me and left me mystified. Years ago, I asked all of you to dance, and you always said no. What was it about me that you all disliked so?" Well, they stuttered and they stammered, and then they said, "It wasn't you. We did not know how to dance. We thought you knew, because we never danced with anyone. We always felt like fools. We were wallflowers all through high school." So, one by one, he danced the girls around the high school gym. His wife smiled as they awkwardly followed him. Then he took her in his arms and glided out the door. The 40-year-old mystery, a mystery no more.
So at the end of this year, when I go looking around for nominees for Best Cabaret Debut of the Year. I'm going to be looking for the name of Mark William. I saw his show at the Green Room, and I thought it was spectacular. He gave me this to read. Mark William is headlining the Highline Chamber Ensemble on New Year's Eve at the McKittrick Hotel, and he will return to the Green Room. Don't miss this show. Green Room 42 with an encore performance of his hit show Come Croon With Me on Friday, January 25th at 7 p.m. Mark that down, January 25th, 7 p.m. Really don't miss it. Mark is really something special. Please welcome Mark William.
Way above the chimney tops, that's where you'll find.
his wonderful performance last night as Ebenezer Scrooge in a new version of A Christmas Carol comes Bill Dyszel, whose show The Internet Ate My Brain is playing at fringe festivals all over the world, or on both sides of the Hudson, he said. So please welcome to the stage Bill Dyszel.
Thank you, Tom. I was reading an article lately, an essay really, about pessimism, about reflexive pessimism. And what they were saying was that people in developed cultures like ours have a tendency to be reflexively pessimistic about things that are actually going well. So sometimes they don't feel hopeful because things are going better than you can really expect them to be. And some of that is due to human nature. You know, there's a natural tendency to romanticize the past and fear for the future. Another one is, of course, we're surrounded by electronic media where, you know, bad news is very urgent and immediate and good news is kind of gradual and you don't notice it coming in. So a couple of possible solutions to the need to feel more hopeful. Number one, throw away your television. Cancel your internet. And there's one more thing that I think is a useful solution that we'll all enjoy.
Without a song, the day would never end. Without a song, the road would never bend. When things go wrong, a man ain't got a friend. Without a song, that field of corn would never see a plow. That field of corn would be deserted now. A man is born, but he's no good no how. Without a song, I got my trouble and woe, but sure as I know the Jordan will roll, I'll get along as long as a song is strong in my soul. I'll never know what makes the rain to fall. I'll never know what makes the grass so tall. I only know there ain't no love at all.
So not everybody's definition of hope would include programming a song that starts the song of love is a sad song. But so be it with the next song, High Lily, which was on my short list. I asked my friend Ann Kittredge to sing it. Now, I want to tell you about Ann. Ann won a MAC Award last year for her debut, and her next show is going to be called Fancy Meeting You Here, devoted to the works of Lynn Ahrens and Steve Flaherty, directed by Andrea Markovici, and that will be in May at 54 Below. So please welcome Ann Kittredge.
My mom was born in a trunk in the Princess Theater in Pocatello, Idaho. Thank you, sir, for remembering the reference. Appreciate it. Kind of ages me that you don't. Judy Garland, Star is Born. Anyway, I think it's fair to say that anyone who was born in the 1920s has had their share of loss and pain and tragedy. And yet my brother says that my mom's greatest gift to him is her eternal optimism. This happens to be my mother's favorite song. And it also happens to be her birthday. On every tree there sits a bird singing a song of love. On every tree there sits a bird, and every song I ever heard could break my heart without a word. Singing a song of love. A song of love is a sad song. A song of love is a song of woe. Don't ask me how I know. A song of love is a sad song, for I have loved and it's so. I sit by my window and watch tomorrow. I'll probably love again. Hi, Lily. Hi, Lily. Love makes the world go round. Love makes the world.
Except for the encore, is Julie Gold.
Thank you. guys, it's a pleasure to be here. And I was here earlier this week with a Christine Lavin show, also produced by Tom. And at that time, they gave me a pillow to sit on. This time, I got a whole platform. And I'm hoping not to take a high dive off of it while in the middle of the high notes. Now, we all know and love Tom, and we've known him and loved him for many years. And this is his last show. And it's like herding kittens to organize shows like this. I don't know how you do it. But you might not know this about him, and that is that he's a Jeopardy champion. Do you know that? Well, now you know. So. And he invited me to do this song, which I wrote 32 years ago, just before my 30th birthday. So how old does that make me? 28. I like, you know what?
I was the same age.
Yes, and you must have sat next to me at Girls High, my math class. And right before my 30th birthday, I wrote this. And since that time, it has only enriched my life. It has brought me to people and places and things that I dreamed, but then became my reality. One simple song, and I was a secretary at HBO when I wrote it. The only reason I say it is that I know that all of us are dreamers. And most New Yorkers are dreamers. And you know, it really did happen. Really, this miracle happened. First recorded by the great Nancy Griffith, and then it was like kryptonite. It just went around the world being recorded and recorded. I've heard it in many languages. I've heard it in music boxes. I have felt it in Braille. I've seen the multiply handicapped sing it. It's been illustrated as a children's book. It's been recited into the Constitution by Barbara Boxer. And the very first time that the Russians and the Americans met in outer space, this was their wake-up call. So thank you for allowing me to sing this twice in 1 week, right before the holidays. It really is a great honor, and we all love you, and we all thank you. Tom Toce. Well, I guess I should say, who is Tom Toce? Snow-capped mountains white. from a distance.
So, but even just sitting over there, the guitar gets out of tune. All right.
Was that what happened when I twisted those dials?
Can you feel you catch on to it? There could be a sing-along aspect to it, but who knows? I don't know. Anyway, song for the season. The stockings all are hung, check. The lights are on the tree. You've written on your wall, best Christmas yet. Well, here's an added asset, a friendly tip from me, a point of view that you should not forget. Don't be shitty to people at Christmas, as shitty as you've been to them all year. They probably deserve it, but you don't have to serve it. Just smile and give them fruitcake and good cheer. It's more than fine to tell them have a happy. Happy what? Well, no one knows, so you don't say. Oh, don't be so darn spiteful. December is delightful, and you can't bust their balls on New Year's Day. Yeah, you can bust their balls on New Year's Day. Da da da. Dum, da da da. Don't be shitty to people at Christmas. It should not take a whole lot of restraint. Just summon some willpower or down a whiskey sour. Fool folks into thinking you're a saint. You only have to fake it from Thanksgiving. For a few short weeks, let nothing you dismay. Oh, don't be so pernicious. December is delicious, and you can be a Scrooge on New Year's Day. Yeah, you can be a Scrooge on New Year's Day. Da, da, da. Da, da. that's just too depressing. It could be, I'm just guessing. Then ask yourself, well, what would Jesus do? I've often thought if Jesus walked amongst us, he'd need some weed to stay above the fray. He'd sense an obligation to heal our broken nation, and that's what we can do on New Year's Day. Yeah, that's what we can do this New Year's Day. Start wrapping presents, so I gotta go.